Trying to get better into the flow of the proper sequence of play here. I called Finland into the battle at this point. I still don't have it completely right. I moved about half my units and then realized, you know, I want to do some ground strikes. So, you know, what I'm saying is, well, I'm disallowing ground strikes here. Now, the Russians have the ability to fly cap if I wanted to, which would allow me to move fighters into a position where they could intercept more easily. The problem with that is I think that fatigues them. I think that flips them. And I don't see any real advantage to that right now. I'd rather... I'm in a position where I can intercept, I believe. Shit. I don't know. If I can find interception, because that may be only half your range or something. Okay, I'm gonna have to find the interception roll to see. Yeah, interception's only half the range. I'm also considering the possibility. And until I kind of see the pieces move, it's hard for me to make this decision. That's why I hate the sequence of play. You really have to kind of be used to the game for the sequence of play to work for you, because you can't figure out what you can do. I'm beginning to get an idea of what I can do here. So, you know, I'm getting closer to being able to play the game by the rules. It's not just a matter of me ignoring the rules. It's a matter of I have no idea, you know, how to make those decisions until I see things halfway in play, which is why I'm actually doing this. And it's kind of questionable why I do it on video, except that, A, I don't know how to play games without a video anymore. That's the issue with the DoD as well. And B, some people asked me to do this specifically. to watch me cheat as I learn a game. okay, that works. But some people are particularly interested in the outcome of this. I think it may end up meaning that I end up not giving you an idea of how the game actually ever works, because I've done so much detail on this, but who cares, really? You know, I have so few viewers anyhow. And this is the way to get less, right? Okay. So what I'm looking at here is interception is indeed half the range, which means the Russians could fly their interception up. Oh, so the question was whether or not I want to use my offensive jet. And I don't know the answer to that until I start positioning things. I think the answer is yes. But then how do I want to do it? And I really kind of have to make my mind up with that. The advantage to using it is that I can recover a lot more of my units. And I think that's advantageous. So I gotta find my headquarters that's kicking around down here. I've got a good one here. Rumstadt down here. 1, 2, 3, 4. Not quite. That's an extra movement. 1. This probably costs 2. 1, 2, 3, 4. I could get to this. I can't get to these though from where I am. So I think I need to move here, and I just heard something that indicates that I probably have a meeting. I'm waiting for something to process, but which sucks because so if I shift these like this, that means I'll probably be able to do that. I'm going to spend my offensive chit, and that's going to allow him to double all the units under his command, which is pretty much all of this here, right? The stupid zone, which would mean I can't reach here either, which means instead of being like that, I'll be like this. If I spend this offensive chit on Rundstedt, that's going to allow him to recover things more cheaply. It also will allow him to double the strength of the units that are trying to punch through here in the center. I couldn't really get Rundstedt up here, you know, and still recover. Well, I've got a bunch of units I need to recover up there too, shit. And I have another general kicking around. Not this guy, I have another one, I think, but I don't know where he is. You know, it's really hard for me to grasp that kind of nature of the game. And, you know, I mean, both sides are gonna be making huge blunders. But the question here is, okay, knowing all this, do the Russians want to fly any cap with their fighters? So like this, it's too far away. This is my fault. I could have put it within interception range. Oops, you know. I am not used to setting up for this game, so I thought I was setting up correctly. On the other hand, there aren't a lot of German flights that are going to happen, and I was looking at doing some ground bombing, which could be intercepted. So like this plane is able to intercept here and here. I've got no air cover here though. And if I cap this guy, I use him up, which kind of sucks. But I may need to. Well, I've already moved some of these. But that kind of telegraphs, geez, I don't think I'm going to be able to protect that shit anyway. So I'm out of range here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Now this has an extended range marker, which I think means that I can reduce his effectiveness to get a bombardment. But if I'm doing the offensive, I don't really need any of that. But over here, I'm not going to be in range of my offensive chip. If I understand the offensive chip, maybe range is not motorized movement range, which had to do with something else. And this is the whole game, you know, I'm constantly, because I'm trying to learn and trying to get some vague ideas of the stuff, I'm going to be constantly moving forward with, I got to look shit up, and I can't play anymore now, and I have no idea where I'm stopping because my computer's yelling at me, telling me I got to go do something. Still kind of jumbled up in terms of ordering, but the Russians decided not to fly CAF. The Germans are flying a ground strike here. This is within range of this fighter. So it's gonna fly an interception. And now we create a line of fighters versus a line of bombers. And I believe only the fighter rolls. Let's see. Let me find the air-to-air combat roll. Of course, ground strikes are in the land combat rolls for some reason, it looks like. And this is naval rolls. I don't remember where air rolls are. Yeah, I gotta find that. So from what I can tell, what we have here is the Russians are the inactive side. They're gonna have a 4 air-to-air strength. If they had additional fighters, they'd have a larger air strength. Based on the additional fighters there. And this has a 4. Now, air-to-air combat value. Is going to be 4 minus 4. Is a 0. We roll 2 dice and add them together. And we get an 18, I believe. Because this counts as a 10. 18 says, the defender X, the defender destroys his own front fighter or bomber. This is the defender in this case. His plane is wrecked. That's going to kill the pilot, too. Oh, maybe. Okay, so now we find some place to get a bookmark because it's all in one big rule book. No big deal there. And let's see if we can find pilots. Pilots are covered in their own rule. I'm sure we can find them pretty easily. The book's pretty good at finding things like that. 14.6, not far from where I was, but far enough I couldn't see it. Now, does the pilot die? He's not in an orange air-to-air combat result, is he? He was in a red one, I think. I don't know, that might be orange. These look like red, but this looks almost orangish, like it's a slightly different color. Okay, so the pilot dies, which means I'm not going to get an additional pilot back for this. And now the plane goes in, unless I want to trash it if I thought this was a lousy plane. Frankly, I can't tell. It looks okay, so I don't want to get it out of my pool. I'm not going to have time to build new planes anyway. Cost me 3 turns to build a plane, you know. So that's been shot down. The Russian interception's been successful. I don't remember which hex it was against. That's one problem with this. If I wasn't, I think I was positioned so I could hit both of these, but this makes that the only hex that could work. I don't remember what I was shooting at. This came from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I don't know. Maybe I was hitting here. I have no idea. I'll put it here because I can't figure out. I think it had both these hexes covered, and that's the only place that I can see that would do that. That's even vaguely safe. So there we have that. And that was an air-to-air combat. Now, what we don't know is whether the bomber got to fire back. Losses from the inactive side do not affect the combat value the active side uses. Okay. So I get to shoot back. And I am also on the zero table. And I only get a 9, which is an attacker cleared. That would mean my bomber would slip through at this point. If I had a parenthesized or bracketed strength, I wouldn't get to shoot back. I wouldn't have any chance of hurting the enemy fighter. But anyway, that's been landed, and I think that's going to be probably my only airstrike. What's not clear to me with these ground strikes is where to find them. They're somewhere over in the land rolls, as opposed to the aircraft rolls. Even though they're clearly just air missions, is whether or not, you know, what I seem to remember from playing is I fly a mission, it's resolved. Then I go fly another mission, so maybe I have another one. But that's kind of at odds with how the regular ground combat's done, where you assign everything at once. I don't like games where, you know, there's different ways procedurally of handling each different thing. But that's certainly what I did, because I tried to do ground strikes over here. Of course, these weren't, you know, that important. But this one, I might want to ground strike that same space again. So now I got to look up the ground strike rules and see if I can find any clue about this or in other rules as to whether or not I have any kind of ordering, you know, imposed on me. Like, can I hit that same space again now that I cleared the fighter cover that could reach it out of the way? See, that's the thing. If the Russians committed cap, they'd use up their planes, and in some later impulse, the Germans could move forward and could do their airstrikes. If I don't commit the cap, like I did here, and there's, I don't think, a marker for cap, so I don't know how you represent it on the board. If I don't commit the cap, well, it's sort of a rebase, basically. If I don't commit the cap, then what I've succeeded in doing, but I have to mark it somehow so I know that, you know, those planes are tired after cap, I think. If I don't commit the cap, what I have to do then is I can strike now, you know. Most of this is unprotected. So now that I've pulled off the one plane, I can hit it. Hit other, at least other hexes, I would assume. After a lot of effort to refine the cap rolls, I can't find anything that indicates what the hell's up with them. So they can fly this to a point specified in the rules about the mission type. And it's attempting to intercept. It sounds like it's an aircraft mission that's limited in the sense that it counts against your missions, but you don't have any missions at that point, which I assume means it flips it, but who the fuck knows? Because other things like escorting certainly should flip you. Intercepting should flip you. But it's not really clear that Combat Air Patrol flips you. And it's also not clear to me what the sequencing of this is. So for example, do I declare I'm going to do ground strikes, and then the defender does all his caps, and then that makes sense, and then I do all my ground strikes at once, or is there some kind of pulsing in there or whatever? And I have no idea, because it's not really spelled out in the rules. You got to kind of make it up as you go as to what works and what doesn't. And I'm probably making it up wrong, but that's okay. In fact, I know I'm making it up wrong. I'm pretty certain that you have to pre-allocate all these. Like everything else in this game, you have to have the entirety of your objectives, every single fucking thing you want to do, completely planned out in your head. And to me, that, you know, that's work. That's not fun anymore. But the game can be fun if you just kind of bend the rules a little bit. Now, the rules say, oh, please be careful to do things exactly in the right order. Yeah, it's important, but, you know, screw it, man. I'm playing to have fun, not to be a logistics engineer for the military who has to plot out every single, you know, force relationship and come up with all the different possibilities, then choose the best one amongst those. That's not my idea of game anymore, you know? And on the other hand, the game comes close enough that if I do twist it just a little bit, I can kind of enjoy it. Anyway, I think I'm all set with the ground attacks. The ground strikes, whatever the fuck you want to call them. And I don't know what else is left. Oh, look, it's time to do my movement now. Yeah, I've already done all that. And you see, here's the thing. It gives me a flexibility as the attacker to do my movement afterwards. But if I don't know where I need the airstrike, it's not going to help me. So I'm just giving the defender a little bit more help here. And then I guess we're going to hit the land combat here. And we'll see whether or not somebody came back with something else. Luckily, my meeting was canceled. It's a pointless meeting. It was like, oh, hey, we don't have this, and you know nothing about it, but you're going to consume it at some point. So can you get on the phone with us so that we can, you know, try to figure out how to get you what you need Why? So I launched one attack up here, which was easily successful. I couldn't find any good odds here. Nothing better than 2-1. Over here, I launched another good attack. Maybe I have good odds here. I doubt it. Let's see. 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. A river there? No. 12-27. To 12. No, that's 2-1. I don't want to do that. I don't even think I have armor. So I'm just not going to make attacks where they're low odds. Here I was able to get really good odds, destroy the unit and push forward, and I'm threatening these planes up here, which means the Russians kind of have to react. I wasn't quite able to overrun them, which would have wrecked them. So you're seeing a pretty limited effect. I did make one low odds attack up here, wrecked myself some fins. I'm looking at, well, I have fins here. Now, here's the question. What do I want to do with Mannheim? I can... flip him to recover this plane. That cost me 2 recovery points. That's all he comes with. That gives me another shot at Leningrad. I don't want to attack it this turn. I don't know what it is. It's probably a 1-1 because he's in a swamp. But if I could flip this unit, I can get really good odds against Leningrad because there's only one unit there. But I have a very low chance because it's swamp, so I only have a 1 in 10 chance of flipping that unit. So I probably don't want to try to bash my way through. Here I got really terrible situation. I took 2 hits to 1. I took better units. He lost an artillery division or battalion or something. Whoop, whoop, whoop. Maybe I'm doing casualties wrong. Maybe when you take casualties on a divisional level, they don't count fully. I don't know. I haven't looked that one up. But now, Rundstedt has 8 recovery points that he can use, and that'll be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I can't quite reach this artillery back here. Terrible. But at least I get some more units to keep punching forward with. It's hard to maintain an attack. You get your units flipped unless you get good odds on the breakthrough chart on the Blitzkrieg chart, or really good odds on the assault chart, you're not going to be able to continue your assault, you know, your advances through all those impulses. And I also want to relocate some of my planes up further to the front so that they can help support, because my attack is just kind of faltering here. I'm really not gaining the kind of ground I think I need to. But that's okay. Like I said, this is an exploration of the system. I'm probably going to screw up in the big game just as badly. I'm pretty damn lousy at grasping this system unless I focus a lot more than I want to.
On my other headquarters, I'm going to cheat and move him up here, because he's got a lot of units he can recover in the north that maybe I can punch further with that. I've got enough recovered here. The problem with doing recovery is you flip your headquarters, and your headquarters was a good combat unit. In his case, it was a 7-point armor that I'm not going to have to keep punching my way forward, which kind of sucks. Oh, now this is only going to move forward one. I can't possibly roll a zero, so we're there. I got to put a red die to remind me. No, I don't. There we go. When I get to the days of decision, though, I do have to worry, because this counter only has two sides, and I need a three-sided. There's three different impulses that can be in play. There's the Western, there's basically the democracies, the dictatorships, and the socialists, all as separate powers. So I guess we're ready for the Russian response, whatever that may be. Russia had some rain in their impulse, and they pulled back a little bit using some rail movement, etc., just to get themselves into a somewhat more solid position. They now have made up for the breakthroughs that the Germans were punching through. They still have a solid southern front. The weakness is through the swamp, which really isn't that much of a threat. If you take a look at swamp movement, it's really expensive. You can basically move a hex. You get the assured hex that a lot of games provide you, I think. I did it. Which allowed me to pull out, although I did rail some units out of there. I railed an additional unit into here and stacked this up. This has two core in it, quite a big strength there. It's not, this may actually be stronger. I still wish I knew what that little gray circle meant. If anybody knows what it means, tell me. I can't find any indication of it. We're getting to the point where the turn might end. Russians obviously didn't end it there, so now we're back on the German action. And yeah, I'm using the die, but I'm also flipping the counter. You know, it's like belts in a suspender, right? I really should get another unit here, just in case the Germans get lucky and trash that. You know, let me see about rail movement. I think I can rail into a hex that I control, because I've got this unit. And I think I've got an extra rail move left. I had three to begin with. I know I used one to get this guy here. He was back here. I know I can rail out of a hex. A second one to get into here. And I think I've got a third one available.
Paula, rail movement does not do what I expected it to do. It flips the unit.
So I've got a problem in terms of covering this area here. And up here, I'm able to move down. I think these can combine, but that's the best I can do. And I'm getting kind of a shakier position. I can't afford to flip units. Big rail moves aren't going to do it for me. I think I cheated and did some rail moves earlier as well to get a unit out of Stalingrad up to the front. So the Russian defenses are actually stronger than they should be, but I'm having trouble finding how to stop the Germans on this next upcoming move. I may have to reorganize how I moved things. I begin to ease my way into playing by the rules. I've launched all my ground strikes before I do any movement or anything like that. Again, this is how I learn a game, really, and it's why you see me more frustrated when I'm picking up new games
because I guess I'm less willing to try to just out and out cheat and then try to fix it as I go along and learn it. And this is giving me an opportunity to play it this way, where I'm able to do my natural cheating. And then I can decide what kind of cheating I want to do, you know, when I actually play. So let's take a look at this one. We're doing an air battle here, and I'm going to mark this. I need a battle marker. I'm going to mark this. This is going to be a ground strike here. The Russians sent an airplane in. The Germans sent both a fighter and a bomber. So the Russians have an air combat of 3, and the Germans have, well, a Hungarian air combat of 4, which means the Russians will be at -1 on the air combat table. And we'll roll 2 red dice for them. And they get a 9. That's an attacker cleared, which means the attacker clears through 1 defending bomber. Well, this is the attacker in this case, so that means the bomber is going to get through. And now the Germans get to fire back at +1 on the table. And they get a 9, which isn't terribly good. That has no effect whatsoever. The fight's essentially over. I'm going to keep these aside while I do the bombardment. I don't know which unit I'm targeting. I'll make my mind up after I see if I hit. I have a pretty good chance, though, but it doesn't work. And now I have to fly back, not necessarily to where I came from. So I'm going to put them close, because I don't want to be too exposed. And with the Russians, well, I can only go 2 back, which is where I was. And that gets rid of that air combat. Now I have another one here. There's another Russian plane. We'll mark that with this die. And here we sent more German fighters, but we're actually going to use this one as a tactical bomber. But it's going to be the lead bomber. Now, I think he has a disadvantage when he's being used as a bomber. We'll see if that's the case, if we need to. But we're again hitting at -1 because the fighter, the Axis fighter, is better. An 8 doesn't clear anything. A +1. A 5. That sounds good. That's going to be a DX. So the defender destroys his own fighter or bomber, and that means a Russian fighter goes under. No. It's not that easy, is it? Oh yeah, these are my fighters. Okay. So now I have 2 bombers. Black will be, well, they're both the same, I think. Black will be the fighter bomber, and we'll see what that comes out. We didn't get a hit with either, and these all abort and go back. And I've got another one here. I took care of this attack as well. That did not get a hit. This is my big, oh shit, I guess I'm doing not a ground action, because I launched 4 air attacks. Well, we'll cheat it here, because I really wanted to do a ground action. I probably wouldn't do all these, but this one would be a higher priority than some of the others, perhaps. Helsinki's probably the least prioritized of them all, because I really don't think I only had a 1 shot at that. So we'll just fudge that. That's fine. Anyway, these German planes have to go back, and we'll take care of that attack as well. I missed something. I think this is an anti-air gun here. Now, the way anti-air goes is it has 4 shots per step, but it can multiply its value. And I think it fires, after air-to-air, but before the cleared-through bomber's attack. It's exactly like naval anti-aircraft fire. Great. 11.59. Section 11 pisses me off. That's where all the rules are. So, it may make sense to have all the different operations under here in some ways, but that's what a lot of my problem ends up focusing on, is there's this one big section in the middle of the rule book that has everything
in it. For every 2 surprise points, increase your air to air. Okay. Bombers which cleared through good air to sea, first anti-aircraft fire. Total the anti-aircraft factors, that would be 4. Locate this on the anti-air row of the naval combat chart. Wouldn't have thought I was on the naval combat chart. Anti-air, so I'll be rolling here. Now, Y is the number of dice you roll, X. Okay, cross-index the final column with the number of enemy bombers that were cleared through. That was 2. Which will be here, so I've got an A of 2. I don't know what that means. Haven't done this. No clue. Okay. The result will be in a form of plus, oh, it's AA here. So the result is a -1, 5. If X is positive, you count the highest of the dice. If X is negative, you count the lowest of the dice. So I will be rolling 5 dice, and I will take the lowest one. I don't know what that means. The lowest one's a 1. Now what? For every 10 points of the total, yeah, well, I got a 1. So that anti-air did crap. If there are any 5 points left, the owner can choose to abort. For every remaining point, 1 further air-to-sea factor does not press the attack. So I would have had 1 less hit, 1 less die chance on those bombers, I guess. All right, anyway, we'll move on here. Hopefully there won't be an anti-air gun poked in there. The numbers just did not crunch out well. I'm kind of running down. I made 1 big assault. I think I ended up taking Minsk here successfully, but I missed by 1. I had a +1 for a reduced unit, but I still missed by 1 and didn't manage to keep my units unflipped. The general back here, whoever the hell this is, Bach, restored some infantry I had back here. He can't do much about the armor. He could restore 1 of it. I'm playing with the option where only armored leaders can restore the armor cheaply. Over here, you know, I threw everything I had, but didn't come up with the numbers I needed. Here, 8 strength points. I'm looking at 11, 22. That's only 2-1, you know? I think the best attacks I could find were 3-1s. So that's what I got here. I think I got a 4-1 on Minsk, which is, you know, high enough that I feel worthy of doing it. But there's still a risk. The German units here, neither of these are white units, which means that's only 2 strength points with some penalties against it. This stuff is white, so it's harder to attack. There are 3 strength points each. But these guys are really... Actually, this may just be a fucking division. Yeah, we don't want that. I don't know how much a division is worth. I mean, it's only worth 1 to begin with, so it can't be worth all that much, so we'll do that. But yeah, I mean, the Russians could do a counterattack here and actually cause some casualties. How much would it throw them off their game, though, to do it? Getting those casualties is sweet. The turn didn't end. For good or ill, it's hard to tell because the German assault is beginning to wear down. And boy, they didn't gain a lot here. This is, I'm just not succeeding with the attack all that well. But that's because I'm kind of blundering around with both sides, really. Russian side of the turn, they perform some ground strikes, actually, knocking out couple of units. I don't know, 1 here. They made some, they couldn't attack here. I was thinking about it, but there's some German air there that protects those. They could have hit here, which actually would have been within range.
I don't think Cap can flip the units because then they couldn't react. So actually, the Germans have to move their airplanes. You know, they can't move both of them up, but they can move one of them up to help defend against possible airstrikes in that salient. Russians are pretty much out of fighters. They use theirs on defensive maneuvers. We did do an overrun into this hex, which destroyed a German mechanized unit, but I couldn't get enough force to really hit anything else. These guys are actually out of supply, which causes them some problems if they flip or whatever. But they're in a town, and they feel safer there out of supply than they would. Actually, they're in supply, I think. Is that a hometown? I don't know. I think that's home, so I think that's actually a supply source. You don't have to actually link up your hometowns, so you can be completely besieged and still in supply. So they don't have a problem there. I was hoping I hit this with a couple of planes. I hit over here with a plane. I was hoping to knock both of the units out of here, and that was the same with one of the other spaces that I attacked. In order to be able to launch another attack, but all I really managed to get out of it was the overrun that happened. The turn didn't end, which means the Germans get to go again. And I have a bonus 10-sider somewhere. Yeah, it's got a 10 on it. Ooh. Anyway, that's it. I'll be going to the con tomorrow, so I don't know how much I'll be, for the next week. So I don't know how much I'll be playing this during that. I may be able to get this finished while I'm at the con, and while I'm there, I'll be playing one of my favorite games, if I can get people to join in on it, which is Empires of the Middle Ages there. It's a really great game. I'm going to be doing it as a kind of drop-in type situation. I figure I can teach the rules in about a half hour. So, you know, if people can get a few hours away to join in the game of it, it's great. And we're going to try to do as much of the grand campaign as we can with people moving in and out as they wish. If people are really excited about it, they can play even without me. You know, and for example, Saturday I'm going to be there most of the day. Sunday I won't be able to be there early because I'll be out dancing Saturday night. So, you know, but if there's a small group that are into it, hey, they can go with what they've got. One problem with WIF, there are many in terms of just trying to grasp the game and figure out what you're trying to do. One of the big problems that I have is with my air units as an attacker, I almost always just do ground strikes to flip units. But there are times when it would be of value to have that extra strength point to get you an odd start. Now, the way I'm supposedly playing, which is rolling a die to see if I make it to the next odd start, but I've been kind of forgetting to do that, kind of makes up for that. It becomes less vital to get to the exact odd start that you want to get to. But still, if you're at least there, you guarantee you're on it, right? So there's still some value to doing that. But for the defender, throwing in ground support makes a little bit more sense, a lot more really, because in some ways each strength point the defender throws in counts as more, and this is common in war games, right? You know, if you can get an extra couple strength points in for the defender, you can drop the odds significantly sometimes with very little, whereas it's much less likely that that's going to happen with the attacker. Again, though, the die roll makes a difference. Anyway, that's just explaining why I generally do ground strikes. I don't have a whole hell of a lot left, and I'm not seeing too much gain for the Germans here. I think we're going to try an attack on the Romanian front, but I've got to move my plane up. And the reason that that's okay, that I kind of want to do that attack, is I've got a leader here. You don't want to waste your leaders. But he can only recover one unit, so it's not going to be that big an effect for him to he's not going to be able to attack twice, basically. So his recovery value is not too helpful. You also don't really want to ignore the fact that you have increased odds. But the problem is, if you attack, if you do an assault, and you don't exactly succeed, the counterattack can hurt. And that comes into kind of almost a World War I type situation that comes out of the game when you're forced to do assaults. And that's very nice. And it's one of the few reasons that I kind of want to look at, play, whatever. And I know there's a new release of it by Compass, actually. The Fatal Alliances, which is the World War I version of World in Flames. But, you know, I'm not willing to spend the money to pick it up. The old version with the overlays, nobody would ever play that. A friend of mine had it, but nobody wanted to touch it. But, yeah. But it's kind of neat to see, you know, the World War I-ish aspect of when you don't have that mobile war, when you don't have the combined arms coming in, when you don't have all these benefits. It's really hard to push ground. And the choice to make the German assaults on this Impulse was probably a good one, because the Impulse ended, I rolled a 3, and we were on the 4 Impulse end. So, you know, and they wouldn't have gotten another chance. They managed to get this and take out some units here, which was of definite value. The reason they took out the units was there was nowhere to retreat to. Which doesn't seem right, because there's a unit here. They could have retreated through there. I gotta fish those units out of the dead pile. One of them's destroyed, but the others, it was a shock result, so the others will fall on the production cycle. But down here, we had an assault on this unit. We didn't throw the Hungarians in because they give a penalty. It wouldn't have even been a full odds shift. It would have been a partial. But it was only a 2-1 attack, and the Germans lost a couple of infantry trying to make it and flipped. And so their position was pretty weak down here. Now, there aren't a whole hell of a lot of Russians, but we could have seen, you know, maybe these two hexes fall and these Hungarians get cut off back here, which could be a problem, although I don't know how big a one it really is. Other than they can't fight their way out of the bag, but the Russian position is not in a strong location right now. In fact, the Russian move probably would be to try to ooze their way out. They've got problems here because now they're cut off and out of supply. If not careful enough, you can't leave holes in your line because the enemy can kind of squeeze through them. And that causes you real problems. And that's something I got to learn that's different from most games in the wargaming era. Anyway, looks like we have a lot of time for the end of turn stuff, which is cool. I was worried we might not. And we'll start looking through those. So for the end stage stuff, I ignored partisans and some of the other stuff, but they're an optional role. You could use them in this scenario. I don't want to cope with them. I got enough trouble coping with the main military section of the game. Return to base, that basically these fleets move down. We'll worry more about that segment when we play the naval game. I don't intend to do a lot of naval adventuring in this. There's a possibility of it, though, and that's kind of the problem. I have to not play unrealistically. I have to kind of cover bases. So, for example, there's nothing in Sevastopol. I screwed up. I could have done a naval invasion. Of course, that would bring up all kinds of ugliness. So that should have actually had a unit in it. That's why I have a unit up here in Archangel, is to prevent that from falling. The final reorg, everything unflipped. And one thing I noted as I'm doing that is, you know, some of these units, they have kind of neat big numbers on them, not huge, but it looks like, you know, hey, I got a 6-4, that's a pretty good unit. And you just kind of weigh your strength of your force by looking at the numbers in a quick way of absorbing. And it's hard to tell what's flipped and what's not. I mean, I'm not talking about when you're zoning in and looking at specific units. I'm talking about when you're trying to get the Gestalt of the board. Maybe as I get more used to it, that won't be as big a factor. But I've got all these circled numbers kicking out there. And, you know, it kind of looks like I got something there that I don't. I have useless units that are flipped over. We're also not going to do the intelligence and peace and stuff like that. But we do have to deal with production in this scenario. Now, this gets complicated, and it's, I'm probably going to be Zoom cutting the video so that I can go look more of it up. But there's off-map production. You know what that means? That means I have to count the on-map production. That sucks. It's something I should have done before setup, because it's going to be kind of hard to figure out what's where. In particular, though, so for example, we're only playing north of Yugoslavia, Bulgaria, and Turkey. So I think those count as off-map, so I don't have to count those. I'm not sure. But, yeah, for the Russians especially, finding the stuff on the board is going to be a pain in the ass, and I'm going to have to add up, you know, all the different production points that they actually have. And that is resources and factories. I don't know if I don't think I'm going to deal with oil in this. Both sides have stockpiles of oil. But yeah, again, an option. I think I've already screwed with that, because when you unflip armored units, I think you need an oil or something. I don't remember. I thought production in Days of Decision was actually translated over essentially from WIF. It doesn't look like it is, and I'm going to have some serious worries. We're going to have to look, because I know it'll be handled, but there's got to be a difference in how it's handled. Production here is simply a pairing between factories and resources. Now, I initially counted my onboard stuff, you know, like three here in Poland. No, Poland is a conquered country, so only the red factory counts, the blue ones don't. But these guys were joined in the war, so their factories do count. Anyway, counting the offboard stuff, I come to 14 and 16. Now, because it's a pure pairing, these extra resources don't mean shit. And that kind of worries me. So I have 14 production points. There's one multiplier, which is over here. So Germany in 1941 has a multiplier of 1. So I'll be only producing 14 points of stuff. I don't know what the Russians have. I have a harder job of counting what they have on the board. Another factor that I had to consider is railing factories away. You're allowed to pull the blue factories off the map. Now, as far as I know, I don't have good counters to handle that. I have these factory counters, which work fine for factories I've added or I've moved, but I don't really have something that works to indicate how many are in the hex. I could, of course, use those factory counters in the hexes where there were factories to indicate there are less, but then I don't have a zero factories marker. I seem to remember there were things. There are these damage markers. Maybe there's something on the back of one of these that's of value. Yeah, this is a factory destroyed, but I think that's if you're destroying all the factories in a hex. But if I completely clear out a hex, I guess that's what I would use. But I think those also apply to, like, if you're bombing them during the game, but maybe those are just damaged in that case. Atomic bombs can destroy them permanently. I'm just trying to rationalize. But one thing I do have to consider, even in this little scenario, is the Russians may want to rail some of their factories out of the way. They've got some stuff on the front line here, like at Odessa, that they should have done. Now, in a game like Third Reich, you do this in kind of an end phase type of thing. Here, you do it during the military phase. It eats up your rail movements. So that's kind of cool, and you know, something I just have not been really paying attention to, but I really ought to get on the ball. I've given up most of the ground. Well, I've given up a lot of ground that has nothing in it, but I got to be careful, because we are beginning, you know, the South has a lot of my production. Can't have counted the Germans right, because they have 19 off-map factories, and I only have them listed as having 14. I think we're going to have to recount them. The Russians are at 28 and 28, which seems pretty cool, but I got to recount my Germans. This time I came up with 24 and 24. I'm leaving it at 24 and 26. This is a problem with this game for me. I'm horrible at counting, so if I'm going to be counting things all over the map, and regularly recounting them, I'm going to come up with different random numbers all the time. unless I can figure out a way like I do in EU of marking changes as things go. And I don't see that easily happening because the changes happen during the combat phases often. It's going to be really tough for me to keep my production numbers up to date. So now what do we do? Well, the core of the production is we have bucks. I have 24 bucks. Hey, is Russia's multiple one as well? Probably. No, Russia's is only 0.5, so they're only producing 14 bucks, and I'm getting 24 for the Germans. And that's probably correct. The 24 factories is the limiting factor, probably. So I can spend on units, and what I spend for the units is sort of the big number on here. But what I gotta worry about is the amount of time it takes for things to be created. So, you know, if I wanna create a regular infantry unit, that only takes me two production turns. So I'd be putting that over here. I'd get to use that, right? Because they're gonna get produced back in Germany. Likewise with planes only cost, the fighter planes only cost me two turns to produce. So again, I'd get a chance to use them and they'd move more quickly. So in this scenario, you know, I'm not gonna be building up tanks, even though historically the Germans probably would be. I'm probably not even gonna be, because they take four turns to produce. I'm probably not even gonna be able to build mechs with their three turn production, because that gets me it here. And I'm 1, 2, 3, 4. I got one turn to use it. It's showing up in Germany. It's barely going to get to the front. It's probably not going to get to attack. So I'm probably looking at, let me buy things that have two turns each. And that means infantry, fighters, and let's see, some of these cheaper attack planes, land support planes, ground support planes, is probably what I'm going to do. And with 24 points, well, infantry costs me 3 points each. I probably don't want to buy a whole hell of a lot of infantry. I'll hold them off. My fighter planes and bombers only cost 2 points each. That's the price here. These guys are from World in Flames, where they cost 4 points, take two turns, but it doesn't count the pilots. But I have pilots in reserve. So I can buy, you know, up to six planes. Well, I can buy up to 13 planes without overwhelming my reserves. So that's pretty, how is this? These numbers, what the hell? Just doing it to confuse me. Okay, so for the Germans, what would I divide up that 24 as? Infantry are my most expensive thing, actually. So how many infantry do I want to buy? If I build four of them, that's six planes. How about I build six infantry cost me 18 points. That leaves me enough for three planes. Does that make sense? I think that's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna build six infantry. And what I do for this is I put all my infantry, and that includes some non-German stuff, in here. And I draw six of them. Ooh, I'm getting some good draws there. Now, you know, if you're used to most games, you want a lot of armor, but I just don't have the time to build it. So that cost me 18 of my 24 points. I'm gonna get six more points. Put my dead infantry here. I figure the planes will be easier to get to the front, so I want to buy the infantry now. Now, if I wanted to buy mechs, or God forbid motorized, and now I'm making a mess because I've got stupid camera in my hand. If I want to buy planes, I need If I wanted to buy mechs or stuff, I would want to do it this turn because I'd at least get to use them. But I'm going to focus instead on 2-point bomber planes. I think I've got... shit. Enough fighters. I can't... I'm just making a fucking mess. And I'm going to have to spend 20 minutes cleaning up my counter trays that they're usable again because I decided to do this on camera. I'm going to just buy all my ground strike planes instead. So I spent 18. I have 6 more. That gets me 3 of these. 1. Yeah, that wasn't a very good buy. 2. What the hell is this? The Finnish plane? Yeah. Okay. So these guys, this was pretty decent for that price. These guys all show up 2 turns later. 1, 2, and I can put them here to help remind me. And the same with the infantry. And when you're playing this with not just 2 nations, generally what you do is you just stack 1 country's production all in a pile like that, so it, you know, there's room for other people to be on the chart. I'll come back and tell you what I did with the Russians as well. I went with 4 quick infantry and 1 fighter plane. And also going to be over here. Get a great plane. Not that old. And really what it comes down to is, you know, I could have bought some of the funkier stuff. There's smaller units that are available, but they take just as long as the bigger units. I had some infantry divisions that might have been valuable just because, well, they don't have real zones of control, so they're not as useful. So largely, you know, where you want to build corps and army, or, you know, where you want a real army in place, I think you draw from the regular counterpool. If you've got little special tasks you want to do, where a division makes sense, that's great. Divisions do add a little bit, but strength point wise, they're not worth buying that extra unit. This infantry, what is it, a 1-2 or something? Yeah. That's half the production that I pay for a regular full-size unit. It's great if I've got something that I don't expect the enemy to be able to attack, but I need to cover no matter what. But for the extra stacking point, no, it's just not worth it. A little bit harder thought is whether or not, well, here's a thought, whether or not I wanted to buy fucking garrison units, which might have been better than infantry. Oh, well, we'll let it go, because they're cheap. But those are divisions. These are core. They're still cheaper, significantly cheaper. Whether or not I wanted to buy, I'm not used to those for whatever reason. I don't know if they were in the original. Whether or not I wanted to buy little toys like artillery and stuff, you know, again, they have their uses, there's no question. They're better than the divisions in terms of being able to impact an initial attack or something. But once the attacks are underway, once the field is kind of open and moving, I find them kind of questionable. They either are just regular units, in which case you don't want to pay the premium for them, or you're using them as ground strikers, in which case they're just not all that impressive. You're better off with air power. So, you know, lots of neat little toys, but maybe not what you want to use, especially for the Germans. The Russians, the artillery is kind of cool because they may not have air superiority, and the artillery can still ground strike without air superiority. So it gives them a little neat option before they get overwhelming air power. And by the time they do, they probably have a bunch of artillery. You also can buy things. You get to select your type of artillery. I think each force pool is different. But what I do have to write down is what I bought. So here I bought, what, 6 infantry, 3 fighters. And the Russians bought, I believe, 4 infantry, 1 fighter. This is important for gearing limits. Because next turn, if I wanted to buy garrisons, I couldn't buy a whole bunch of them. Next turn, if I want to buy infantry, I can buy 7 with the Germans. I won't have that ability. But I can only buy 4 fighters. And it may, my gearing limits may prevent me from using all my points next turn. On the first turn of every scenario, you're assumed to have infinite gearing. But what you buy at that turn affects your next turn's gearing immediately. I think we're done. Let's just double check this with the first turn. I don't really know where all the victory hexes are. I don't know. There was a claim in the scenario. Let's see. Something like 18 of them or something. I don't know. Some ridiculous number. And I found 2. 9 on-map objectives. Each, I don't know what they are, but some of them are things like Helsinki. I think the Russians hold 2, unless maybe Riga is 1, so that there's a 3rd one there. But yeah, there's got to be, you know, like the capitals down here and everything. I guess they're all important enough that they count as key cities. That makes it tough for the Japanese, right? Well, no, because when you're playing the Grand Campaign, everybody's kind of got an expected number of points they have to reach, and it's your differential from that you're scored on. So, like, you know, it doesn't matter that you have tons of them near you. You'll be graded on how many of that tons you get, not on how many overall you got. All right, let's send this one up because it's about over in terms of time, and I believe we're starting a new turn. We'll put this little thing here because we got to start it all from the beginning.